Hello and welcome to the Chiefs Report. I'm Sarah Shunk. Chief, today we're going to get right into it. Let's talk about school security.
Well, as we know, September is kicking off the start of the school year, and we had a tragic event in Connecticut last year with all the children that were killed in Connecticut. So last year we stepped up security, and of course this year in the fall we've had the summer to look back and work with Utica Community Schools. So we've implemented a community policing style with the schools, mm-hmm. where the officers are assigned to specific patrol areas, and they patrol that area, and they also get out of the car, go into the school, meet the principal, the staff, look at the building for security, make sure there's no security lapses, and also the lockdown procedures that they have that they've implemented now. Utica schools have been working closely with us, so that officer gets to know the building. So if he ever has to respond in an emergency, mm-hmm. he's a first responder. We would never want to think about an active shooter, but if there's an active shooter in the school, we've trained for that and they respond to that. So we've stepped up school security. Also last year we added a school liaison officer, so we now have two, and they're plainclothes officers most of the time, and they also are now traditionally been in the high school and the junior highs. Now they've dropped down to the elementary schools where they go by on a weekly basis, meet the staff, talk to the principal, get to know the security plan, and we work closely with Utica Community Schools to make sure we have the tightest security we can to make sure we're protecting our most vulnerable citizens, which is young children.
Right, definitely. Has there been feedback from the parents or anything?
Yes, there's been a lot of positive feedback because we've also been putting patrol units, especially in the month of September and into October, at the opening and the ending of school. We try to get officers down there in the parking lot so that the parents have seen our school security. Mm-hmm. And Utica Community Schools has put out some newsletters and information. So yes, it's been very positive from the parents, and they're very pleased with the security with the school and with the police department.
Rolling from school security to bus safety, let's touch on that because the buses are everywhere.
Yeah, the buses are all out, and I know it gets a little frustrating for all summer you're driving along the roads and everything's clean, and all of a sudden now you got buses stopping, kids getting off and on.
Yeah.
And I think most people understand with children and bus safety, you got to stop. Unfortunately, we get too many reports from the bus drivers that some people get impatient and go around buses with red flashing lights. That's a very serious traffic infraction. I believe it's 6 points off your license, up to $500 fine.
Wow.
And I know the magistrate and the Judge Shepherd down at 41A District Court take a really tough look at that, as we do. So we want to make sure that everybody stops, be safe with the children. The lights are flashing, stop. If you're not really sure about yellow or red, just stop.
Yeah.
When they're flashing yellow, that means you're supposed to slow down and stop. When they turn red, stop, don't go around. The bus drivers are trained to take down license plates, identify drivers, and we do get reports from Utica Community School bus service, mm-hmm. from the bus drivers, and we do follow up police reports and we issue tickets, and those people end up in court. So you want to be real careful, make sure you stop for school buses.
Oh, definitely. I know that they stop on the busy roads and things. It's one thing when they're on a side road. People, I think, get caught off guard a little bit on the busy roads, but they still have to be cognizant and realize,
Van Dyke and Chaner, which are very busy five-lane roads, mm-hmm. a lot of people get confused. The buses on the right or left side, you have to stop regardless
both
of
ways.
What direction you're going.
Definitely.
You need to stop. And again, if you're ever at a doubt, always stop.
Yeah.
I mean, the police officers are not gonna be concerned if you stop. Now, if you don't stop, that's going to be a problem.
Let's talk about the Citizens Academy. What do you have?
Well, our Police Academy, I believe, has been going on for 5 or 6 years. A very successful matter of fact. The one in October is already filled up, and mm-hmm. we're going to have one in the spring. But it's our way of having direct contact with citizens in the community, so they can be kind of the eyes and ears of the police department. With the TV and CSI and all the things out there, mm-hmm. people have sometimes a misconception about what police can do and what they don't do. And so the police academy is a chance for the citizens to come in. They get to meet the detectives, the evidence techs. The prosecutor's office comes in, and they have this training, and we go through all different aspects of police work so that they understand exactly what we can do and what we do. And then they go out and they talk to their neighbors and their friends, and they talk about the things that the Shelby Township Police Department does, mm-hmm. and how can we respond to crime. So there are eyes and ears, and they also bring that out into the community. So it's been very, very successful, and we always fill up, and we always have a waiting list. So if anybody wants to get into the police academy, get a hold of Sergeant Casabon, and he'll let you know when we'll start taking names for the spring session.
Who's the typical person that does the Citizens Academy?
We get a lot of seniors because they have more time.
We get a lot
of seniors, and then we get some young people who are interested in law enforcement. When people see that, they think of police academy. They think that they're going to actually come and attend an actual police academy. It's not really set up that way, but it gives a chance for some younger people interested in law enforcement, police work, a chance to come in and actually talk to officers and see what we do. And we give a tour of the station. They go into our 911 dispatch center, so it gives them a good idea of exactly what goes into law enforcement.
Okay, good deal. Yeah. So they're, you know, basically they're trained to just be a little bit more alert and...
Yes. They really understand, because there's a lot of misconceptions, again, with television and in the media about exactly what the officers do. They get to understand that their patrol techniques, what we do in patrol, talk again about the things that we're doing in community policing. We really, since I've been the chief for the last 2 years, we're pushing community policing so that the officers are getting out of their cars, into the businesses, talking to the residents, getting out in the parks, getting out into the schools. So we talk about the traditional things that police do and some of the new things that we're doing.
What's the radar trailer? I've heard a little bit about it. I don't quite understand.
Well, it's taken a little while to get it up and running, but we're actually having it up and running. It took us a little while because they unfortunately delivered the trailer to a police department in North Carolina instead of in Michigan. So we had to, took a while to get our trailer back.
Okay.
It's a very enhanced, computerized, it's solar powered, it's state of the art. It was about an $18,000 purchase.
Wow.
The good thing about it is it didn't come out of the budget. It was drug forfeiture funds, that paid for it.
Oh.
So actually our drug dealer friends paid for our radar trailer.
Oh, nice.
One of the biggest complaints in law enforcement is speeding in subdivisions with children. And parents call, and we get a lot of calls. This is going to give us a new tool that we can put in a subdivision, and we can not only have a nice kiosk, big sign that gives some messages and tells them their speed, we also have a computer in the trailer that can record all the cars, what speed they're traveling, what times they're going through, so that we can download in our computer system.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can determine whether there actually is a speeding problem, because sometimes it's perception.
Yeah.
You know, it's that one high school kid or the one kid that just doesn't pay attention, and he's the one zipping up and down, but 90% of the rest of the people are traveling safely.
Right.
So we want to make sure we put our traffic enforcement units in the right place. So the trailer can monitor that, track that, give the statistical information to make sure that we have our traffic enforcement in the right place.
Okay.
Because it's a big community, 35 square miles, 75,000 people,
right.
A lot of subdivisions, and we get a lot of complaints. Mm-hmm. We have four traffic officers, so we want to put them into the actual places that they're speeding. And also, we also put them where the most accidents are.
Okay.
You know, Shaner in 23, Van Dyke in 23, those busy intersections. We try to have officers there for running red lights, those kinds of things. So this will be a big added tool to the toolbox, so to speak, to do more effective traffic enforcement in subdivisions. And also, we're using it around the schools, the school zone. And again, back to schools.
Right.
Slow down when the flashing yellow lights are. Mm-hmm. It might be a 35 or 45 speed zone, but when the lights are flashing, it's 25.
Right.
And we really do a lot of heavy traffic enforcement around the schools this time of year.
We're going to kind of wrap up our conversation here with what is going on with the budget and finance in the police department.
Right. Well, right now we've had our budget approved by the board. We're dealing with a deficit that ranges between $1.2, $1.6 million.
Mm-hmm.
So we do have a budget deficit that we're working with. The good news for the police department is we're going to have some officers retire here, possibly 5 to 7 can retire this year, and some more the following year. So with attrition and officers leaving, we're going to be able to, I think, deal with that budget. We're working with John Kazar, a financial consultant, with the township. We're in the second prong of our four-prong process that we're looking at. He's going to complete a study and get that to us shortly. I've been working with him on that. And we'll take a closer look at our long-term finances. But I think we're in pretty good shape until 2017 with our budget. We have a surplus in the township and the police department. I've given some options to the township board that they're going to take another look at. And I think we'll be okay with our financing till 2017. There's a lot of growth in the township.
Mm-hmm.
The assessments are starting to change. I think come 2016, 2017, we might have to take a look and see how the budget looks. But I think the police department's going to be in good shape until at least until 2017. board's going to look at some of the options that I've offered. Mm-hmm. John Kaiser's going to have some options, and I think some of those are real positive options to help us balance our budget in the next couple of years.
So you've got a nice team of people working together to make everything, you know, go smoothly with them.
Yes, we have some financial help from the outside. Mm-hmm. My staff, we've been working on the budget, and I've been working with the township supervisor, and we have some good options. We're in the phase two of a four-phase process, mm-hmm. and we'll present those options in more detail to the board here soon, and they'll have several options to help us balance that budget, and I think we'll be in good shape until 2017. And in 2017, that's 3 or 4 years in the future. We'll have to see how the township assessing and the revenue, how it picks up. Our problem with the budget has really been revenue, because of the drop in the value of homes and assessed value have dropped.
Definitely, yeah.
Our budget's been reduced every year for several years now.
Right.
I want to assure the public that we're going to have some reduction in staff, mm-hmm. but it's not going to affect the road patrol. Our road officers are going to stay the same. Our response to 911 calls is going to stay the same. We have an excellent response time in Shelby Township, and my primary goal as a chief, and pretty much any police chief, wants to have the 911 responses be our priority. So our road patrol is not going to change. Some of the other things that we do, we'll have to adjust and move some people around and mm-hmm. reorganize a little bit. But I'm pretty comfortable that we'll be in pretty good shape.
Good deal. Yeah, and there's a lot of new development happening here in Shelby. So, yeah.
There's a lot of
change.
a lot of building going on. And it increases our revenue and helps mm-hmm. us balance the budget.
Awesome. Well, that wraps up this Chief's Report. I'm Sarah Shunk. We'll see you next time.
Tommy's a really good kid. He's really helpful around the house. He loves to play with his friends. He loves school, too. My Tommy would never even think about trying alcohol. Isn't that right, sweetie?
Real kids are curious about alcohol. 40% try it by the 8th grade. Talk early, talk often, get others involved.